Evening.
Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many, but we now know that each Lord and each God must have a name. Elohim is a title, but Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that the Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. Yahweh is pure spirit. In this pure spirit state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the sum total of the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior when he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the tabernacle pattern. By the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led Moses and the children of Israel out of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come up on the mount, up on top of Mount Sinai, and he showed him a vision, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Later on, he instructed Moses to build one just like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, and a court round about. And these three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we go forth to show proof that everything in the universe abides within the threefold state of this tabernacle pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follow. First, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without the distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is to speak truth. Tonight we're going to have a scripture lesson of Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 1 through 19, because it's long. We'll have a prayer by Dr. Iggy Ramirez, and the scripture lesson will be read by Irene Ramirez.
And we'll have a
selection of music after the prayer.
How do you select?
Very good.
Excellent.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
As I'll bow our hearts for a moment of prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father Yahweh, we ask that you bless us tonight, and we thank you for having us come and meet together to learn more about this great panoramic, stupendous vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Kiffer Kinley. All this we ask in your precious holy name, Yahshua the Messiah, let's all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, and I'll be reading Matthew, the 5th chapter. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn because of sin, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see Yahweh. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of Yahweh. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manners of evil against you falsely, for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they that prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It shall henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it given light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shineth before men, that they may see your good works and glory your Father which is in heaven. Think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I have not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot, or the smallest part of the letter, shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whomsoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, and shall teach men so, ye shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do the teach ever shall do the teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. I have read Matthew, the 5th chapter, 1 through 19. Let's all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, good evening again.
Good evening.
Tonight's Tuesday night, and it's usually our workshop night, and we'll still go through the question and answers if anybody has any one of them. Our normal workshop instructor, Dr. Will Williams, is out of town for a little while right now, traveling across the country. So for our first speaker tonight, I would like to call Dr. Iggy Ramirez.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Will's going to be out for about a month, but he left some instructions for us to do if you were following the last couple of classes. That we're going to start going reading about Moses again, especially for those that want to get up and talk about doing a lecture, how we have to, know this event here in Exodus, okay? With Moses, because we all begin, with the Messiah, It's like we read in the 5th chapter, 5 and 17. Let's read that verse. Matthew 5 and 17.
5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Okay. Now, when we go through that, it's going through the mission of Yahshua the Messiah. Okay? Now, we have to realize and keep in mind the events by this ages of dispensation. Okay? This is a time, okay, that the law was given. Okay? Mm-hmm. And the Jews were under this law. Jews and Jews only. Okay? We were taught in the churches that we were under this law. Mm-hmm. But it didn't pertain to Gentiles, only Jews.
Right.
The Messiah was under the law. Okay? But his mission was to fulfill the law. Just as it says in the beginning of the chapter, read the verse, the first verse.
And seeing the multitude, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying.
Okay, now we read a bunch of Beatitudes. Blessed is he, blessed is that. But there's a verse in there, okay, 21.
Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit murder, and whosoever committeth murder shall be in danger of the court of justice.
And just above that, he said he came in to fulfill at 17. So he's fulfilling something, okay? And that's what we're going to start learning about here, okay? Now, as it was said, we have some rules that the Messiah placed. Okay, if you want to learn about him, we have to go to the Messiah and see how we learn about him. Okay, let's get John 5:39.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me.
Now, he said, ye search the scriptures. Well, when I came in, I didn't know what scriptures were. I read the Bible, but it didn't make sense to me. New Testament, Old Testament. Mm-hmm. Old Testament, a lot of killing, you know, a lot of this and that. And I was confused why I thought that God was love and the Lord was love. And here he's slaughtering babies and whatnot, right. You know, from animals all the way down, you know, to man. I didn't understand it. New Testament, I was so confused because people say you got to do this and then all of a sudden you don't have to do that. And, you know, I couldn't make heads or tails until I met somebody in his teaching.
Right.
Okay, that kind of pointed the way through the Holy Spirit in them. Now we have a chance to understand the Bible, what it means, okay, that these are historical events. This is a history book, you know. Yeah, we call it a Bible. But it's history, okay. It goes all the way back to the first man, okay. And then down to this day, okay? But it's all pointing to Yahshua the Messiah, the one that died on the cross, okay? Now, 5:39 talks about the scriptures. The scriptures are from Genesis to Joshua, okay? And from Numbers, oh wait.
Genesis to
Malachi.
From Numbers to Malachi, that's the prophets, okay? The law and the prophets. First five books of the Bible is the law, and the second is the prophets, like 34, 37 books.
Okay? Genesis then, through Deuteronomy and Joshua through Malachi.
Yeah, that's the law and the prophets. Or the law and the testimony, other people want to say, okay? Now we have a little leaflet in the last part of the Bible, and it says it's the New Testament. Well, that's not correct either. Okay, we'll get into that later on. But we want to learn about the Bible, what it says, and what it points to. Okay? And it all points to Yahshua the Messiah. Okay, now, so we come in, we sit and the guy gets up in front of a woman or a man or whatever, he starts to tell you about the Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, and how we have to go to the law and the prophets. Finish reading 5 and 39.
I'll start at 39 again. Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify me. But ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not
life. Okay, that says that they're going to get life. Go back up there, read that again.
That but you may ye, be. You know, before, 39 again?
Before that. Yeah. You think you have eternal life.
Yeah. Right? Ye search the scriptures. For in them ye think ye have eternal life, and there they which testify me.
Stop. See, they think they have eternal life by what?
Doing the law.
Mm-hmm. Practicing the ordinances. Okay? But what did he say?
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye might have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me.
They testify of him. Mm-hmm. Not the Jews. But him, Yahshua, well, the thing is, after a while he'd been in his teaching, you learn why they didn't understand these things. Because there's nothing in him to understand it with. They just went along with the program, okay? They went on breaking this law, okay? Day after day, year after year. I mean, when they were out here in the wilderness for some 40 years, that's what they had to do, okay? They have to follow what the high priest says and bring their sacrifices here. Okay? Now that was under the law. Okay? Read.
But ye will not come to me that ye might have
39,
life.
Go back to 39.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. For they are they which testify of me. But ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
Okay. Now that's the point where you start reading these things. Is I know that you don't have the love of Elohim in you. What is that? What's the love of Elohim? The Holy Spirit. Okay? That's why he knows that they're not pointing to you guys. They're pointing to me. Okay, read.
I am come in my Father's name.
Is it, I come in my Father's name. Read.
And you receive me not.
And you receive me not. Now, when we get introduced to this teaching, the first thing we want to tell them is about the name.
Right.
The true name of the Heavenly Father, Yahweh, his true title, and the true name of the whole, of Yahshua the Messiah, okay, the Savior. Okay. We want to tell them about that. But we have to learn how to go about doing that. So we go to these scriptures, okay, in the so-called New Testament, because they are a testimony from the apostles, what the Messiah said, what he did, how he did it, okay, and so on, because they pointed to him. Now, go ahead, read.
But I know you that ye have not the love of Elohim in you. I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. Let another come in his own name, him we will receive.
Now it's been shown to us the simple things. No J, no Jesus.
Right.
Okay? So we have to go do this research on our own, and we'll be telling the new people, you got to go see this stuff for yourself. Okay? Because once you see the truth, it'll be implanted in your head. Now, you can deny it all you want,
right,
but you know you saw it. As far as Yahweh, you have the tetragram, okay? It's just four-letter consonant, okay? Written in the Hebrew. It is written from right to left, okay? Now, they had the true name. How do we know we had the true name? That's when we start back in Exodus. Okay, let me get this chart here. I love this chart over here. We had Lloyd Lawless have this blown up. And it's a page out of the Elohim book, the first volume, that we'll be reading into as we go on. It talks about The founder talks about Moses, okay? Now.
Can we continue reading?
Yeah, go ahead and finish up that scripture.
44. How can ye believe which receive not honor of one another, and not seek the honor that cometh from Elohim only? Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuses you, even Moses, in whom ye trust. For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me.
No,
for he wrote of me.
Now he's talking to the Jews at that time, okay? Because they're under that dispensation, okay? An age. So he tells them there's one that accuses you, even Moses, whom he wrote. Now, when does this happen? Moses came around when? The year 1490, when we start the recording that is written in the Bible about Moses, 1490, BBY, you know? And it starts talking, where we pick up about Moses, okay? Here we have this this picture here, or this drawing of Moses with a shepherd's staff, okay? And he has sheep here. And let's pick that up in Exodus.
Exodus 3:1.
Now this is where we go when we explain how we get the name of Yahweh Yahshua. Okay, read.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mount of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush, and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the afflictions of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I have come down to deliver them out of the land of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites.
Okay, now, so Moses in this situation here, out here in the land of Midian, okay? He married the priest of Midian's daughter, Jethro, okay? Mm-hmm. His daughter, and became his shepherd, okay? Now, if you want to fill in the blanks, you can read this. Read it when you get home to yourself. And when you read this, it'll implant in your mind about how these events happened. But we're picking out the finer parts, okay? The parts that we want to get some understanding out of, okay? Now, so this a vision appeared right here. It says, vision of Yahweh, Elohim, to Moses in the burning bush, okay? Now, Moses sees this vision, and this angel here introduces himself to Moses. I am the Elohim of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay, and it goes down to say they didn't know him by his name. They only knew him by El Shaddai, mm-hmm. which means Almighty Provider. Okay, and he tells Moses he's going to send them down to Egypt. Okay, and the conversation is Moses, the rain, because of Moses, when he was down here in Egypt, he committed a murder, or he killed an Egyptian. Okay. Which turns out to be, with a little bit of research and stuff, that happened to be the son of Pharaoh, okay? Which was a judge, okay? We'll leave it right there. So Moses fled out of the land of Egypt, okay? Because he was a fear of Pharaoh, okay? So Here we show Moses fleeing, got a little road here, up to there, and he gets into this land here. Okay, this is the point where Dr. Ken is explaining this in the Elohim book, okay? Now, and it goes on to say, well, you got to go back down, okay? But Yahweh assures that that Pharaoh that was down here at the time of Moses, he's dead already, okay? So Moses, you know, you don't have nothing to fear about. So Moses start making up excuses, well, my speech is inadequate, okay? He's a stutter. I met stutters. I went to school with stutters. So I kind of know about stutters. And it kind of made me laugh because it's hard for them to get out a word, you know? Yeah, well, we're kids, so everything was funny when we're kids. But anyway, that's the excuse that he made, okay? But Yahweh said, well, you got a brother Aaron down there, you know, but he's on his way up here to meet you, okay? So, as the story goes on, Moses said, okay, now, when I go down into the land of Egypt, okay, down here to the children of Israel, okay, in the land of Goshen, that's where they're all living, and they shall ask me, who sent you? Just get that verse.
You want it in King James Version?
Don't matter. Yeah, King James Version first. Well, I make a point.
Okay.
Excuse me.
I'll read in verse 13. And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses.
Okay, stay right there. Now, out in the world, which we came out of, all we knew was the name of the Heavenly Father was Lord, okay, God, and Jesus Christ, okay? Now, Moses goes down there and says, the God of your fathers sent me unto you, okay? And the children of Israel shall ask me, what is his name? That's a silly question, you know? Think about it. The God of your fathers sent me unto you, and they want to know what his name is, and we think his name is God. So that's when the research comes in. So we have them do research on Yahweh in the dictionary or encyclopedia, and it breaks it down to the tetragrammation, okay, the four-letter consonants. And how this, matter of fact, if you're in school and you have a holy name version of the Bible, which is it has the true, correct names in there, in the preface, it tells you all about these names, okay? And it's really interesting when you do read it, you know. Maybe we'll read it, okay? Get the preface and where it starts to talk about the tetragram. Let's just read a little bit about it because it's really research when you're on your own and you go out there and you research this stuff for yourself. And nobody's around you and say, oh my goodness, this is the truth. Good, you know. Yeah, you could even Google it nowadays. So. When it talks about Yahweh, and then it tells you how they put the diacritical marks in there so they don't pronounce it Yahweh. Okay. Let me try to draw it up here. I'm not professing to be any kind of artist or anything, but it was kind of like the way they showed me. Okay, a tetragram is... Oh, I got screwed up. YHWH. Okay, in English, it's YHWH. Okay, Hebrew, it's How you spell tetragram? T-E-T?
Yeah, R-A.
M, not A.
Huh? R-A.
Tetra.
G.
G.
G. Yeah.
Gram.
Tetragram.
R-A-M-M-A-T-O-N.
T-E-T what?
T-E-T-R-A.
O-R-A.
G-R.
G-R.
A.
A-M.
M. T-A-T. A-T-O-N.
M-M.
There's two M's.
Oh, two M's?
Yeah. And then an A?
T-O-N.
T-O-N.
Tetragram.
N at the end.
N? Oh, yeah. Tetragram.
There you go. That's good. That looks right.
Yeah.
Tetragram.
Okay. All right. So, the way the Hebrews read Yahweh is this. This is read from right to left, okay? In other words, it's this. Right here. Now, what happened over the years that they're under the law and Yahweh's name was sacred to them, they kept on breaking the law, Yahweh would punish them. Okay, they would have consequences. So after a while, you can read the history of it, that they changed it, they put these diacritical marks, if I can remember. Something like this, to get them to read Adonai, okay? Instead of Yahweh, Adonai, okay? Because every time they would use Yahweh, they were so into the breaking of the law and stuff, they couldn't keep it, Yahweh would punish them. There's like a ton of bricks falling them, okay? Now, for us to pronounce the word, the name Yahweh, because it's YHWH in English. And these are four consonants. There's no vowels here. Okay, if you look up the tetragrammation. Okay. So where do we get it? How do we get it to make it pronounced? We know it's Yahweh. Okay. Well, that's when we rely on the Bible, the story, the history. Okay. Now, the name Yahweh is, I looked it up. He who brings into existence what exists. Okay? Now, it is twofold as far as male and female. Yah being male, or masculine part, in a way. Talk about being nervous. Is a feminine part. Okay? Yahweh. So, how can we prove that? The feminine part. Well, didn't we read it? We have to go back to Moses? Mm-hmm. Now, Genesis, either in the King James or where it says the author of the book of Genesis. Who wrote Genesis?
Moses.
So we go back to Moses. And we'll get, as we go on, we'll see why we go back to Moses. Why, how he wrote these books. But now we want to understand the name. Okay? So, read the first verse there in the first chapter of Genesis.
Genesis 1. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters. Keep going.
Okay, drop down to the sixth. Oh, I keep on reading.
And Elohim said, let there be light. And there was light. And Elohim saw the light, that it was good. And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness. And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And Elohim said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters.
Okay, jump down to the sixth day. Because remember, We want to keep on track talking about the names. So what we did, we showed where Elohim is creating the heavens and earth, which is going to be explained later on too. But we get your mind on the beginning, okay, or the start, okay? Read
26. And Elohim said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So Elohim created man in his image, in the image of Elohim. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he him. And Elohim blessed him, and Elohim said unto him, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. And Elohim said, behold.
Did we really read this the sixth day? Okay, keep on reading. Go ahead and finish reading until it goes down to the evening word with the sixth day.
And Elohim said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of the tree yielding seed, so to you it shall be for food. And to every beast of the field, and every bird of the heavens, and to every creeping thing upon the earth wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for food. And it was so. And Elohim saw that everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day.
Okay. So in that we read, Yahweh Elohim created the first man, created in the image of Elohim. Okay. Now the man was made of body, soul, and spirit. Okay? Body and soul, spirit. Okay? Now, he created him from the dust of the ground. Okay? Which we call Virgin Mother Earth. Okay? Before anything else, any human being was created, he was the first one. Okay? He was, like I said, created in the image of Elohim. Okay? I heard that the founder would call him, he'd be like a Xerox copy, you know, of Elohim. Okay? Now, that's the first man. Okay? His name was Adam. Let's read that where he called him Adam.
I'll start.
So we're going to read about this first man, what his name was. Okay.
And the womb which Yahweh Elohim had taken from woman, made he a woman, and brought her unto man. And the man said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. Oh, you want to call his name Adam?
Yeah. That's going to come up next. Well, anyway, when she gets that, this body formed and made his likeness, he called Adam. Okay?
She has it.
You got it? Anyway, the first man's name was Adam, okay? So we placed that in the masculine part of the name, Yah, okay? So we take the A from Adam and place it there between the Y and the H. Well, now we have Yah. Now we want to see the feminine part of the name, And we stay in the Bible. We don't go out there and research in a dictionary or anything, because they're just going to pull it right out of the Bible themselves. So when we go to the event where Genesis 2 and 21.
2:21. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, and the man and his wife.
Stand on the other side, please.
Okay. Oh yeah. That verse is here. Get to the verse where he puts the man asleep. That's not up here.
18. And Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man.
2:18 or 1:18? 2:18. 2:18.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis. Read.
And Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept, and he took the womb and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the womb which Yahweh Elohim had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her unto the man. And the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh.
Okay. Why don't you look up where she's called Eve, but get that verse where he says that... I guess when he's tossing him out of the garden, that their name shall be called Adam. Okay, both of them. The reason why is because the woman was taken out of the man. Okay? In other words, that shows you something. Okay? That the Creator is female and male within himself, or male and female. Now, back in the day, in the 70s, late 60s, this women's movement came out, you know, women's liberation, and they repeated this thing with taking off their bras, burning them, and all this stuff. I remember watching it on the news, okay? Will went over it the other week, part of it where part of the thing they're saying, God is dead, okay? Because they couldn't understand the things that we're trying to show. Just like we all try to read the Bible, there are different religions doing this, saying that. They're confused. It says, look at all the wars, look at all the killing, look at all the, you know, the mayhem going on the streets. God is dead. He's not doing nothing. That was the argument. And then the women, all of a sudden, says, why can't we have a female God? You remember that? You know? They wanted to make God female. He was female. They didn't understand, but they had a movement where they would call him, I don't know what they call him, but God is female. They made they started their own little church, I guess, or congregation, and they believed God was female. This is back in the late 60s and early 70s. I remember, because I was growing up at that time, you know. And I remember these things, because we get into this teaching, and if you don't understand his purpose or anything about him, you come up with this stuff. You try to please your own mind and try to understand, well, okay, He's female. If he could be male and female, well, us women, we believe he's female. Us men, well, he's masculine, he's God, you know, a man. But anyway, we know, we read these events here, okay.
You want 3:20?
Yeah, well, whatever it says about their names, Eve and Adam, if you could pick it up, whatever, you know.
Yeah. 3:20.
Because it talks about the woman. Of course, the woman and the man. Okay. But we want to get the names of the woman and the man.
23:20 of Genesis. And the man called his wife Eve, because she was the mother of all living.
Okay. This woman, or the womb that was taken out of this man, created Yahweh Elohim, a woman. Okay. And Adam called her name Eve. Okay. Now we got the vowel that we can insert in the feminine part of the name Yahweh.
Right.
Okay? And that is the E. Woman. Male and female. Heavenly Father. Now, in the beginning of our class, we give a moderation, okay? We say, now Yahweh is pure spirit, okay? He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. In other words, you can't see him. You can't describe him, okay? He's invisible, okay? The only way you can understand him is through his son, Yahweh Elohim, the one that introduced himself back here to Moses,
right?
Okay, which is also called the Word, okay? And the Word came unto me, and the Word is, they go into churches and says, this is the Word of God, okay?
Yeah.
Well, God is Elohim, okay? They're just saying it twice, but they don't understand what the Word is.
That's right.
There was no book back there. Even when they were writing down the scriptures, it was just scrolls, okay? That's all they had was scrolls. It wasn't compiled until years after the Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection, okay? Now, so Yahweh is invisible, but yet, to start to understand, he's male and female, okay? In other words, what happens physically when a man and a woman get together and they want to have offspring, okay? They have a little creation themselves.
Right.
Okay? 9 months later, 40 weeks later, you got a bouncing baby boy, bouncing baby girl, baby twins, okay? But without them two, you know, they can't produce only one. They have to be two, okay?
Right.
Male and female.
Right.
Okay? Now, showing in his son, Yahweh Elohim, which took on shape and form so that Moses could understand, okay, out of him came his whole creation.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh Elohim is male and female within himself. Okay? Now, Elohim is a pluralistic name too, okay, or title. Okay? So he's male and female. And that's where we see that now we can understand how the creation came out of him, okay? Now he can be seen in visions, and some people have seen him in visions. I heard it from themselves, how they saw Elohim. Just for a split second, because they said his brightness was so bright, you know, that they couldn't stand it, you know? And this creation just came right. Now, Moses saw him, okay, and we have this here in this panoramic vision given to our founder, and just to stop and say this, that after the founder had this divine vision, panoramic vision, and revelation, panoramic means unlimited view in every direction, okay? That's the type of vision this man had, and he put it up here in pictorial pictures, okay? Now, here we have this tabernacle because we're going to read how Moses saw and 70 elders witnessed this sight here, or this vision of Elohim, okay? They saw this, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, 70 elders of Israel, okay? And Moses saw this image, this form here, okay? Then after that, Moses went up by himself and he saw this tabernacle, okay, shown in a vision. And then after that, he sees Yahweh Elohim in part, not in totality, in part, because we have this half man here,
mm-hmm.
and how the creation came out of him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if it came out of him while he is in part, well, this creation is in part, okay? To where at the end, we have him here, a whole body here, okay? That means something. We won't get into it, but it's kind of like when we get into the later charts over there. But in part, he brought this creation in. It didn't take all of him, just like it didn't take all of Yahweh,
right?
Okay? But just part, okay? And then, this is the creator in shape and form, Elohim, okay? Now, we went to the name Yahweh, and the one that introduced himself, Yahweh Elohim, to Moses, okay, And he says, now when I go back down to the land of Egypt and say unto them, let's read that out of the Holy Name Version. Now, this, the Holy Name Version is a Bible with the true names inserted in them. Okay? This man did it recently. As a matter of fact, he is an Italian
Jew.
Mm-hmm. Okay? What was his name again?
A.B. Trainer.
A.B. Trainer. Okay? Yeah. The Scripture Research Organization. And also, they had the organization, the Holy Name. The Sacred Name Movement. Okay, all these things are out there during the time of when the founder had this vision. Now, the founder, after he had this divine vision and revelation, panoramic one, I'd say, he said, I had a divine panoramic vision, but don't believe me because I said it. He said, make me prove it unto you.
Right.
Beyond a shadow of a doubt. And that's what we're imparting to you. Okay, because he's shown this to the students of the school, made charts to explain what he saw. Okay, now you go out, you research these names and with the stuff that we're telling you and showing you, and you make your decision. Okay, now all I can say is have the truth to accept untested points or truth, okay? Have the strength to do it. You see it for yourself, you read it, just have the strength to accept it. Mm-hmm. And once you do that, Yahweh Elohim, or Yahshua Messiah, the Holy Spirit will start working with you, mm-hmm. okay? But you have to accept it. Some people know it, know the true name, they know it's true, but they still want to do those other things. Mm-hmm. And we'll talk about those other things. Or just not playing, just not even using. They'll keep on using these false. Matter of fact, Lord and God are not even names. They're titles.
Right.
Right.
Okay. But they believe, that's how strong this delusion is. They believe Lord is a name, and they believe God is a name. We all went to school. We all had English. What's a title? A title is describing something. You go to England, that's all they talk about is lords out there. You got lords for everybody. Lords for landlords, whiskey, or whatever. Okay? Gods? Well, let's look at it down here in Egypt. Now, if you did some studying about back in history, and they talk about it, you go to museums and stuff, they always got some, what do you call it? What are these words come to me? I can't even. An exhibition of Egypt, and they have little statues of certain gods and stuff that they worship. Okay, you can read about them also in the Bible. You know, do some research. You find out about these gods from the Nile, all you know, from worshiping frogs to everything. Right. They had apparently a god for everything. These Egyptians, yeah. And who was down there with the Egyptians? The Jews, the 12 tribes of Israel, or Jacob, okay? Now, they lived down here, okay, in this land, okay? And you can read about how they got there in the last chapter of Genesis, the last few chapters, okay? It talks about Joseph, and he was a forerunner down here in the land of Egypt, how he got there, and how the children of Israel got here in the land. But the point is, what I'm talking about is the gods they had down here. So Moses had to explain to him, read it in Holy Name. Because when I go down.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
Exodus 3:13. And Moses said unto Elohim, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel and shall say unto them, the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asher Eya. He said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be, he has sent me unto you. And Elohim said, moreover, unto Moses.
Okay, so Moses said unto Yahweh, or unto Elohim, this is Yahweh Elohim in shape and form, as an angel, okay? The angel in the bush. When he goes down there, what should I say his name to, you know? Like I said, you can read it where it says, pick it up, look for it where it says, by my name Yahweh was I not known unto them, only by El Shaddai. So he asked him, what should I say? He says, Ayah Asher Ayah. Here on this chart it says, I will be what I will to be. Okay? And he gave him some signs to prove what he was saying. Okay? Mm-hmm. He told him, what's in your hand? He goes, a rod. See that rod he had right there? He said, cast it on the ground. He cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from that, you know, that serpent. And he says, pick it up from the tail. So Moses reached down and picks him up by his tail, and he became a rod again. And he said, stick your hand in your bosom. So he stuck his hand in his bosom. He said, now pluck it out. He plucked it out, and it was white like leprosy. If you don't know what leprosy is, Google it. It'll show you pictures, okay? And he says, put your hand back in your bosom. He put it back in. He said, take it out. And it was flesh like his other flesh, okay? He'll be that snake on the ground, and he'll be that diseased hand.
That's right.
Okay? Those are the signs that he gave him, okay? And he had to go back into Egypt to show those signs, okay? That Yahweh was doing what he said he was came to do, deliver the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, okay? Through his mighty hand. So, did you find that where he said, by my name Yahweh, was I not known to?
Yes. Exodus 6:3.
Okay.
And I appeared unto Abraham, and unto Isaac, and unto Jacob, as El Shaddai, but by my name Yahweh was I not known to them.
So he's telling Moses, I appeared unto your forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Mm-hmm. The question would be, well, how come they didn't write about it? Mm-hmm. It wasn't time for them to write about it. Only the time where it came up to Moses, because we have to understand he's got a purpose, okay? And when it was Moses, he's showing something, okay? Now, but did you read by his name El Shaddai?
Yes, it sure did.
And El Shaddai means Almighty Provider. Mm-hmm. That's all he knew him from the time of Adam all the way to the time
of Moses.
El Shaddai, okay? Now, when the Messiah comes on the scene, he says, then another come in his own name, him shall receive. He says, I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not.
Right.
His Father's name is Yahweh. Okay? Now, there has to be some kind of, I want to use a word, relationship in the name. Mm-hmm. If you say, I come in my Father's name, just like you come in your Father's name.
Right.
Either your name is Smith, Jones, Williams, Ramirez, Salas. That's your father's name. Mm-hmm. Okay? Same thing. So this man, Yahshua, he was walking around. His name was Yahshua, not Jesus. There's no J in the Hebrew, remember? Latin right. Or Greek. Mm-hmm. That's why we have to go back and read about this name here. Okay, now you read about his birth there in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, about his name, you name him Emmanuel, that means Alvin with him. Because see, all these names and title are a unity, okay? Yahweh, Yahshua, Yahweh, Elohim. Yahweh, Elohim. This means Yahweh in shape and form. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's one manifestation. This is the second manifestation. Yahshua the Messiah in the flesh. Okay? In other words, it's fulfillment. Mm-hmm. This is the beginning, and this is the ending. Okay? The end is declared right from the beginning. Okay? As it says in the prophets, Isaiah. Okay? So, when he comes in shape and form, the first man, Adam, was made in his image and likeness. Okay? Now, when the penalty was placed on the woman, Okay. Read it, go back to Adam where the it says that Yahweh has given you all the fruit of the garden, but the tree that is in the midst of the garden, you shall not eat.
Okay, Genesis 2 and...
Yeah, that's right.
2 and 7 and 20? No.
Can we 2, I'll start 2 and 12.
Okay.
And Yahweh Elohim took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And Yahweh Elohim commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou shalt may eat freely, but the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die the death.
Okay, you touch that tree, you're going to die. Okay, there's nothing good in that tree. You touch it, you eat it, you're going to die. Now, this is Adam here standing by himself. Okay? Later on, you see him sitting here with his wife. Okay? So, either way, either he heard it, well, she heard it while she was in Adam, right, or Adam told her after she was taken out. Okay? So, they both knew the penalty of touching and eating of that fruit. Okay? Of that tree. Death, instant death. Okay, they knew nothing about death. Okay,
right.
They knew nothing about immortality. Okay, so now, and it happened that his wife Eve went up and was looking at the tree, and a serpent called the devil. Okay. The serpent was like they use it as a type of his
characteristics.
Yeah, treasury.
Characteristics.
His character.
Yeah.
Yeah, the character of a snake. Mm-hmm. Okay. Some people actually believe it was a physical snake. Mm. You know, snake in the grass. No, he just used it as a symbol.
Okay.
A type. Okay, that's his character. Okay. Now, she beguiled the woman to see that the fruit was pleasant, that it was tasty, that it was good to eat. Mm-hmm. And then she took it and gave it to her husband. And as soon as that happened, they both died instantaneously. Okay. Now, death. Okay. So we come out. Okay. How can I say this? So the thing we want to see here is the principles, okay? Now, this is a descending chart here, okay? Now, we have Adam dying, talks about him dying here, okay? His death, okay? He's kicked out of the garden, okay? Down here, okay? Now here, we have him with his hands over his face, you know, like burying his eyes, you know, because he's condemned, okay? He was told not to touch or eat. Now, Yahweh made him coats of skin and kicked him out of the garden, okay? Now, we have, let's get 1 John 5 and 17. So does that satisfy everybody with the name, the explanation of the name, how to get to it? You know? How he said, I come in my Father's name, you accept, you know, and his name is Yahshua, not Jesus.
You want 1 John 5?
17. I mean, 1 John 5 and 7.
5 and 7. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one.
These three are one. Not three. Right. Like I said before, over there in that chart, Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua, that's the unity. Deuteronomy 6 and 9. Our Yahweh is Yahweh unity.
Right.
I think it's 6 and 9.
Deuteronomy 6 and 4.
6 and 4.
Hear, O Israel, Yahweh our Elohim is Yahweh a unity.
Not a unity. Where do you read Trinity? That's something they made up.
Right.
Okay. And they teach it to the seminaries, they teach it to everybody. A Trinitarian's concept. Okay. But here, John 5 and 7 starts off with, read it over again.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
There are three that bear record in heaven.
The Father.
The Father.
The Word. And the Holy Spirit. And these three agree. Are one.
Yeah. Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. These three are one. Two manifestations of the invisible Yahweh. Okay. Read on.
And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one.
And these three agree in one. The one who? Yahweh. Okay? Yahshua, Elohim. These three are one.
Right.
So we go back here to Father Adam, Mother Eve. They broke the law. Okay, that was given to them. The death, burial, okay, and resurrection. Or in this case, you want to use blood, water, and spirit. Okay, these are the witnesses that bear witness of the Father in heaven. Okay, Elohim, two manifestations. So we have Adam, the blood is. They come out of Adam and went to the four corners of the earth, which is mankind. Okay? That's a lot of blood. Oceans of blood. Okay? When he was kicked out of the garden, it says here, sweat of his face.
Right.
Okay? He had to till the ground for the sweat of his face. And man's been sweating ever since the time of Adam. Oceans of sweat. What is sweat? Water. Or perspiration.
Right.
Oceans of water. Okay, now it says over here, let's get Genesis 6, 3 and 16.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I speak loud, so I probably don't need a microphone. You said the death, burial, and resurrection, and I'm caught on that. I see the death. When he has a death, when he partakes of the fruit. I see the burial when he's cast out of the land of Egypt. But I don't see the resurrection. Is that in the childbearing?
Well, that's what we're going to read right now.
Okay, cool.
No, he's cast out of the garden, not Egypt.
All right, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
3:16. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy pain and thy conception. And pain thou shalt bear for children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, Behold, thou hast hearkened unto the voice of the wife, thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, Thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake, and sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field.
Okay, Genesis 3:17-19.
In the sweat of thy face shall thou eat bread, until thou return unto the ground, for out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, unto dust thou shalt return.
Romans 5:14. And there's a verse there in Thessalonians where it says, the woman shall be saved in childbearing. Mm-hmm. Looking back to Moses and the law drawn out.
Romans 5:17 says, For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they that receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Yahshua Messiah.
Right. That is a very important point. Why? Degeneration in the first Adam. In other words, death reigned from Adam all the way down to Moses. Everybody's dead. Okay, remember we read back there in in Matthew, where it says that these things pointed to him. Right. You don't have no salvation in this. They point to me, Joshua. Okay? So death reigned from Adam to Moses. I think I had it marked here in Thessalonians, where it talks about, or 1 Timothy 2 and 15.
1 Timothy 2:15. Yeah. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing, if they continue in faith and in love and in holiness with sobriety.
Now, what does that mean?
It's a resurrection.
It says in the prophets Isaiah that the woman, the virgin, shall conceive and bear a son. Mm-hmm. That's the birth that she's supposed to have. The woman shall be saved in childbearing, mm-hmm. which is Yahshua the Messiah. And he came 4,000 years. Let me get this out of the way because I don't need it right now. Okay? Right here at the end of this age, that's when the Messiah made his appearance. And he made his appearance to a virgin, which his name was Mary. Now, the Roman Catholics, Dr. Kennedy gets into detail in the fourth volume, you know, how they took this woman and made her a saint. All she was a vessel, mm-hmm. okay?
Right.
Nothing more, but they have her raised up like she's, a saint, you know? That she made prayers for you too and stuff. You read nothing. There's nothing about, the only thing about Mary is when the time of the Messiah's birth. Okay? Now, she shall be saved by childbearing. That's our spirit. Okay? You have him eating bread from the ground. As we have the bread, intercession, Yahweh speaking to him, every word comes out of the mouth. Okay, and we have this angel here holding this flaming sword, which is light, okay? Now, so we kind of covered the bases here in this chart, descending, okay? And we've shown that how Adam was made, body, soul, and spirit, okay? With Yahweh Allah breathing the breath of life, okay, he was made a living soul. He placed him in the garden, and Moses was a witness to this rerun that he was shown up here in a vision. Okay, now we see that he put Adam to sleep. Okay, this is the second chapter of Genesis. Okay, and he made an incision in the side and took a womb out. Okay, and formed a woman and presented her unto Adam, her husband, in the garden. They were bliss, heavenly bliss, you know,
right.
A man and a woman and love and all this, okay? And we'll get into a little bit more explanation on these charts, but I'm just going over the names, okay? To try to show you that the names are through the Bible, in the Bible, okay? Now, in Isaiah, let's get it in the sixth chapter, I believe, about his birth. Behold, Yahweh shall show you a mystery, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, call his name Emmanuel.
I have 7:14.
Go ahead and read that, same.
Therefore, Yahweh himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel.
So Moses wrote this down in Genesis. Now Isaiah, later on in the prophets, after they're up here in the land of Canaan, okay, to the Holy Spirit, he prophesizes of this.
Right.
So he's drawing out what he sees. A virgin shall conceive, a virgin mother earth. Okay? and shall call his name Emmanuel, or Elohim with us. Mm-hmm. Going back here. See Elohim here? Adam is made in the image and likeness, because Moses said it, of Elohim.
Okay. You want 9:6?
Yeah, read that.
Isaiah 9:6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, of the Mighty El, of the Father of Eternity, the Prince of Peace.
And we know now that Yahshua Messiah, when he appeared through the Virgin Mary, okay, that seed implanted by the Holy Spirit in him, that once he was born, that was Yahshua, okay? And the government is going to be placed upon his shoulders. He shall be called Wonderful. Although he was walking around doing miracles, they didn't know him.
Yeah.
They didn't know him. They wanted to kill him because of the things that he was saying, that he was prophesizing. They didn't understand. They still don't understand him today.
Right.
They call him Jesus. You know? No, this is Yahshua. His father's name is Yahweh. Okay? This spirit being here is the same as this here, but it's inside of him. Mm-hmm. He just came in the likeness of sinful flesh. But once he went through his death, burial, and resurrection, and ascension, still that form here. Okay? Now, if we believe, okay, that that's the truth, we believe in the truth, his name is Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, and Yahshua is the son of Yahweh, and we confess that he has come in the flesh,
mm-hmm.
Now that spirit we realized in you.
Mm-hmm.
I say come in you, we realized in you. In other words, this veil here is rent and torn. Now we can see within, I say within you, that spirit that's ruling over you. Okay? It's always been there.
Right.
But you didn't know it. You're in ignorance. Okay?
Right.
Now, now other people may go through another way of explaining the name. But this way, I think it's a lot more easier when we start showing this vision. Okay? Now, we started off with explaining that Moses had to go down here in the land of Egypt. Okay? And Moses were thinking ahead of time because he knew there were many gods down here. And they said, well, this god this god that. And we're going to learn about those gods. Anyway, he says, what god shall I say came up to you? And he didn't go down there with Lord and God. He went down there with Elohim, Yahweh and Elohim.
Right.
Okay? And he says, he's the one. Okay, that's going to bring you out of the land of Egypt.
Right.
Now, the mystery was that Elohim was down there already. Okay?
Right.
In the form of Joshua or Yahshua. There's no J, so it has to be Yahshua. Because we read over in the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Is it 10? The Apostle Paul writes this down because he too had a vision. And now he can understand what he's been spouting off all these years about the scriptures.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 1 Corinthians 10:1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all immersed into Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
Okay, now this is the Apostle Paul after the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. He was converted. Okay? Before that, all Paul knew was this.
Mm-hmm.
Carnal ordinances. Okay? The prophets. He didn't understand what this. All he knew was the Yahshuans weren't doing these things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They were talking against this stuff. Paul was upset. Okay? So when it came time, he was out there persecuting the Yahshuans, okay? Having them killed and all that, you know? And this is another thing in Yahweh's purpose, okay? How these events coming all the way down from the early Babylon, okay, up to the pagan Rome and papal Rome, okay, how this all festered up, okay, into the dragon bringing in these carnal ordinances, okay? And then how we have a way out, okay? But all this apostate, okay, stuff was going on, cardinal ordinances restored, okay? What do you mean cardinal ordinances restored? Well, didn't Yahshua nail it to his cross?
Right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. All these nails right here, these arrows pointing to the nails, okay? Colossians 2, 10 and 15.
Colossians 2:10.
And the other one get the
Colossians 2:10.
Hebrews 6:1-3.
And ye are complete in him which is the head of all principality and power.
Did we read that in the prophets? In Isaiah said he shall be a prince.
Right.
Okay, the government shall be upon his shoulders.
Right.
Read.
In whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands.
No, you have to go way back to understand that. You have to go back into the law where Abraham was up here. Okay? That he was all through the land of Canaan and stuff. Okay? And now through him, his son, Isaac, we were going to be blessed. I say we, the world. Okay, not only the Jews, because a law was given, or a covenant was given to Abraham.
Right.
That he was going to be blessed with a son. Okay. And Yahweh is going to give him a son. Okay. Here we have the Noetic covenant, human government. We can get into that too, Melchizedek and Abrahamic kingdom. Okay. The priesthood. Now, Abraham was told, okay, that he had to circumcise everybody in his household. Maybe we can pick that up over there in Genesis, okay? It's not up here. Get Genesis 14:18-24. It talks about the Melchizedek priesthood. And it might touch on Abraham. Oh, the Abrahamic promise. Let's get Genesis 12:1-3.
12:1. And Yahweh has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindreds and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing.
So he's telling Abraham to get out of the country. We have a little map here. Out of the land of Ur, for the Chaldeans, okay? To get out of the land, and that he was going to make him a great nation, okay? Yeah. So he did that, and then he said he's going to bless him. Let's get to where he's going to give him a son, and he's going to make him a great nation, and you know, I read this stuff, but it just doesn't come back for some reason. But we have people who can look to those scriptures talking about Abraham. And that's where the circumcision begins, because we just read about it, that he's in Hebrews 6:1, that about the circumcision made without hands. Okay?
Can we read that real quick?
Yeah.
Okay, that's Hebrews 6:1. I'll start. Therefore, leaving the beginning of our doctrine of the Messiah, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from works of death and of faith toward Yahweh, of the doctrine of baptism and of laying of hands and the resurrection of the dead and the eternal judgment. And this will I do if Yahweh permit.
Okay. And go back to Colossians 2:10-15.
Colossians what?
2:10-15.
Colossians 2:10. And ye are complete in him.
You are complete
in him.
In Yahshua. How do you say over here? Okay. See the woman dressed in the sun? Okay. Read.
Which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands.
Okay, back then, they had to have a physical circumcision. We all know what that is, right? Mm-hmm. Doesn't get into the bloody detail.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this circumcision is going to be made without hands. Mm-hmm. What does it mean? Spiritual. This is the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. We see the physical, again, Romans 1, 1:19-20. That's the theme song of the school. When I came into the school, that's what everybody was saying at the time, you know.
Romans 1:19. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
These things are clearly seen. The invisible things of him are clearly seen. Now we begin with Yahweh is spirit. Okay? And we just showed what his name was. Okay? Because we can't see him. Okay? But we do see the things that Paul writes down how he understands Yahweh, how we can understand Yahweh. Read.
Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
And we just read about his supernal nature, which is Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. These three are one, a unity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? We have it up here, and it's getting kind of wore out. But on this shape and form, we have Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. These three are one. Supernal nature.
Right.
Now, the things that were made, we go back to Moses, and he goes up into this mount, okay? 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu. Moses saw the Elohim of Israel standing upon this sapphire stone here, okay? Now, it was like heaven in its clearness. In other words, it was a spirit being, okay? Angelic, okay? The angel, okay? Now, after that, he sees this tabernacle pattern, okay? I didn't want to do this, but it was going to be like another level. But anyway, he was up here 40 days and 40 nights. Just tell me that, okay? 40 days and 40 nights. Yahweh, when they came into the land of sin, that's why we have to read these things, read the events.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses goes after Yahweh spoke to him from the burning bush here. He commissioned Moses to go down here in the land of Egypt with his brother Aaron. Okay, Aaron was going to be his mouthpiece.
Right.
He was going to speak for Moses. So Moses like whispered to or told Aaron what to say, and Aaron would speak it. Okay, now. They went down here, and they went to Pharaoh, as you read, and Yahweh told them to tell Pharaoh, let his people go. Also, Yahweh said that he wasn't, because Yahweh was going to harden his heart. Now, these are the little details that we have to read about. Yahweh was going to harden his heart. And Moses, why would I go ask, you know, Pharaoh, let him go, if he's not going to let him go? But anyway, according to Yahweh's purpose. Okay? So he goes up there a few times to ask him to let him go. And Yahweh says, okay, the first time he poured out, there was 9 devastating plagues poured out on the land of Egypt. Okay? The first 3 were over the whole land of Egypt, including the Jews. Okay? Huh?
First 10.
Yeah, the first 3.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last 7 was poured out only on the Egyptians. And the other one we point out was the last plague was the plague of the death of the firstborn. Okay? Now this is the one I realize that people get a little mixed up here. Okay? The 10th plague. Here certain things happen. Okay?
First of all, he calls Moses and tells him, this day is going to be the first month of you, okay? Or the first year and the first month, okay? And you read that over there in the 11th chapter of Exodus, okay? That is very important, okay? Because that explains, okay, we get into later, but it explains the birth time of Yahshua the Messiah, when he was going to be born, okay? Read.
12:1. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh spoke unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month.
Now, this is setting up the sacred calendar to the Jews. Okay? They go by the lunar calendar. Okay? Now, we go by the Gregorian calendar. Okay? But anyway, the first month was Abib, corresponding with our April. Okay?
Right.
That is considered April, May, June, springtime going into summer. Okay? Now, so in this month, this is the 9th, this is the 10th and last plague that was poured out on the land of Egypt, giving them, setting up the calendar, okay, and also setting up the Passover. Why it's called the Passover. Now he tells them on the 10th day, let's continue reading.
Okay. This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they should take to them every man a lamb according to the house, according to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house. And if it be too little for the lamb, let him take it according to his house, according to the numbers of souls.
Now, this is what this lamb has to be, because it's going to be a type.
Right.
Remember, everything along the prophets points to the Messiah. This is a type of this lamb here. Okay, read.
Every man according to his eatings shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish. A male of the first year, you shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats.
Okay. In other words, he had to be taken out from the Jews. Okay. From those carnal Jews. Okay. That flesh. Read.
And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly shall, of the congregation of Israel, shall kill it between the two evenings.
Okay, death. Read.
And ye shall take the blood, and strike it on the two side posts, and on the upper doorpost of the houses, wherein ye shall eat it.
In other words, in the inside of your house, you get this blood from the basin, wham, 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 strike it. In other words, big splatters everywhere. Why? Because these nails are going to be hammered into his hands and his feet. Okay? And the fourth point of blood is like the lentil, which is this
thorns.
Crown of thorns, big thorns, and they just smashed it on his head, and that was a bloody mess.
Mm.
So let's strike it. And you have to make that show, that strike, in the inside of their house. Why in the inside? Where's our blood?
Inside.
In the inside, right?
That's right.
So, read. When we have our blood, read.
And they shall eat the flesh in the night. Roasted fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat of it. Eat not of it raw nor boiled at all with water, but roast with fire his heads and his legs and his with his inwards thereof. Ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth until the morning ye shall burn with fire, and thus shall ye eat with it. With your loins girded, with your shoes on your feet, with your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the deities of Egypt. I will execute my judgment. I am Yahweh.
So he told Moses he was going to pass over the land of Egypt. And where he didn't see the blood in his side, the death of the firstborn of that household was going to die, whether it be man or beast.
Right.
Now, he didn't tell anything to the Egyptians. He just talked to the Jews. So if the Jews were obedient, the Passover would go over and nothing would be happening to them. But they had to be ready to leave.
Right.
Okay? So that happened that night where the angel passed over and where he didn't see the blood from the beginning, I mean, to where Egypt started to where it ended. Blood was all over the place. Death. Death of the Egyptians. Even Pharaoh's household.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody escaped it.
Mm-hmm.
Animals and humans. Okay. Now, when Pharaoh realized what was going on, he called Moses and Aaron and told them to get out, you know, and have Yahweh bless them too. But Yahweh hardened Pharaoh's heart again. But that's after the Jews spoiled the Egyptians, went out there and took the goods and all the valuables they could handle, you know. It says they had to have the kneading boards on their back and they had to be ready, okay. Dr. Kenny would make a little thing like, the kneading boards on their back. Why? Because they're going to be kneading them to build this tabernacle over here.
Yeah.
So, it happened. So that was the beginning of the Passover. It was a little feast here. Roast lamb, unleavened bread, bitter herbs. Okay. And what I hear, those bitter herbs was like a dandelion wine, you know, because that's all they had out there. Dandelions, you know, and they made a wine out of it. Okay. So, that's what I heard some of the guys did research on back in the day.
Bitter herb was because the bitter herb was for them to remember the bad times they had in Egypt.
Yeah.
The bad times. Yeah. But did it work? But they had a remembrance every year. They had to keep that feast. And when things got bad, when they started turning against Yahweh, Yahweh would remind them about the times they're down here in Egypt. Okay? He'd bring it to remembrance how it was down here and how he brought them out through the Red Sea by the hand of Yahweh or by the hand of Moses. Now, we have a death all through the land of Egypt. Now they had to get ready because they were leaving Egypt and they all left and they all followed this phenomenal sight, which was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And they followed this cloud all the way up to the edge of the Red Sea. Okay? Now, as I cut short, they started murmuring the hair that had hills on the side and they had this big ocean in front of them. They started murmuring, and Moses said to Joshua, "Oh, these people are, you know, this and that, and you know, they said, tell them to stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh, which Yahweh shall save them this day." Okay? And he told Moses, "What do you have in your hand? A rod? Raise it." So Moses, when he lifted the rod, there was an east wind that came through here, tunneled up, and dried up the land, and they went over on dry land. We don't have time to read it now, but if you read it, go back and study this, you will understand that some people, even in the movies they show, I used to watch it, I thought it was so holy. They're sloshing through this mud, and the kid picking up fish and putting it in the basket, and all the way to the other side.
That's not so.
He said they went over on dry ground, you know? So they went over on dry ground, okay? And they went over. In 1 Corinthians 10 chapter. Now we have a death, burial, and a resurrection, because when they went on the other side, okay, the Did you get it? 1 Corinthians 10:1? Yeah.
Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual food, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them, and that rock was the Messiah.
That could be explained in more better detail, but I just want to show they went through the Red Sea and were baptized unto Moses. Now, if Joshua came to fulfill, here he is with John, okay, in the Jordan River, baptizing Jews, or dead Jews. In other words, they came confessing to John that they couldn't keep this law.
Right.
Okay? And now the ones that were, how can you say, that were, like knew they couldn't keep it and knew they were damned, you know what I mean? It's like Adam when he came out of the garden, you know, they went to John because that's what they had to do. It says all the Jews all around Jerusalem came unto John to be immersed or buried in the likeness of Joshua's resurrection. So Joshua, when he did it, he completed the baptism. They were still going on because they were still under the law. But this is where he fulfilled it.
Right.
Okay? Now, they're talking about this event here. Well, John, well, where did he? What tribe was he from? Levi. His father was a high priest.
Levi, yeah.
Okay.
Zechariah.
So John is a Levite here, baptizing the Messiah. We have the Jews here, and there's a verse that says, "When Israel was a child, I called my son out of Egypt."
Yeah.
This is his son coming out of Egypt by the hand of Moses. And Moses was what tribe? Tribe of Levi. Because if you start reading in Genesis, that's where it begins. It begins. So we have a history build up there. We could go back and look and explain these things. Okay? How they were buried in the cloud and in the sea. Okay? And baptized. Death, burial, resurrection. Okay? Death, burial, resurrection. Okay? Blood, water, spirit. Blood in their houses, or blood all through the land of Egypt. Burial in the Red Sea. Water. Resurrection, it came out through the hand of Yahweh by this phenomenal sight, which was a cloud by day and a cloud pillar of fire by night. Spirit. You see the principles, and we see the witnesses just in this event. Okay, time is up. And hope to see you guys on Thursday. And that's it. And hopefully you got something out of it. Oh, let me stand up here. Sorry, Will. It's been a lot of time since I did this stuff. Okay. That concludes our lecture for this evening. And as far as announcements goes, I know that we have the Albuquerque event coming up in November, and it seems that it's full right now. So if you want to go, you need to reach out to, who is it that we need to reach out to make sure that somebody may have canceled?
Margaret.
It should be the emails.
Yeah, check your emails for the registration. Check registration to see if there's any availability if you still want to go in case somebody cancels. Do we have any other announcements? Okay. Any donations may be received by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reisler.
We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 to 9:30 p.m. And on Sundays, we hold classes from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. And every fourth Sunday of the month, we have a Spanish class held here from, what time is it?
9:30
a.m. to 10:45 a.m. Let's all stand for the doxology here. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Small crowd today.
Yes. We got through it though. Class must go on. How'd I do?